Hello everyone, welcome to the Geo Ecologist. I'm Dr. Krishnanand and you have been watching my videos on physical geography as well as human geography on my channel. So if you have not subscribed it yet, please do subscribe. And in today's session, we are going to learn about the concept of faults and how it is different from a fold. So we are going to learn about faults and its various types and characteristics. So let's go ahead.
So now after we have learned the folds and its types in previous lecture, the next part of this diastrophic earth movement is the creation of these faults, the types and characteristics that we are going to learn in today's session. So this word fault comes from old French, that is faute, which means opening or gap. So that is where the catch is. In fold, what used to happen, the layers was there in continuity. There was no opening or gap between them, right? So what is the difference? In fault, there is moving away or there is a gap creation. That is important here. Now let's go ahead and look into the characteristics. So another thing that is important when we study the faults is the crustal fracture. So remember, there is a fracture, a breaking away. So crustal fracture refers to the displacement. Now remember the word displacement, that is changing position A to position B. So there is a displacement involved of what? Of rocks along a plane due to tensional and compressional forces. So that we already know that tensional and compressional forces are important, acting either horizontally or vertically. Remember, for fold, mostly horizontal forces were important. But for fault, horizontal or vertical, both of them or many times combination are important. So crustal fracture depends upon two factors. Number one is the strength of the rocks. So what is the strength? How the rocks are made? How dense are they? How packed are they? And the second is the intensity of these tensional forces. So how intense is the force? That is important. So the strength of the material and the intensity of force, that is what is the basic factor behind crustal fracture. So now when we study fractures, there are two types that is important to understand. One is called joint and the other is called faults. Now when we say joints, remember there is no displacement. Largely the entire beds, which was supposed to be like this earlier, now it has eroded from this part. So what was there? Different layers as we see. And what happened? Because of the tensional forces, there are lots of these lines as you can see. So these are called joints, right? As we have joints in our body, right? Between the bones. So these are joints between different layers. But what do you observe in the second image? There is a displacement. Remember, if we want to fit in, what has to happen? This part, remember, now look at this particular place. This and this. This was supposed to be like this. Now it has gone up and it has gone down. So there is a displacement involved. So that is where we see fault happening. So joint and fault are important when we study the fractures. So they are two parts of the same concept. So that is joints and faults. So a joint is defined as fracture in the crustal rocks wherein no appreciable movement of rocks take place. So in joints, there is no appreciable movement. But when we talk about displacement, when we talk about movement of the crustal rocks, remember the endogenetic process, the forces that we see. So here what we see is the resultant that is called fault. Why? Just look into this image. Earlier, the plane was like this, right? Now what has happened? Has gone down. So what has the position A and position A dash is now changed. So there is a change in position. That's why it is called fault. And this particular line which we see here, so this along this particular line or along this particular plane as we see, right? So as we saw in the folds type as well. So this is called fault plane or fault line, right? So that is important here. Now apart from this fault plane and fault line as we study, some terms are important like dip, strike, then direction and angle. So that is important here. So what is this dip, what we say? Now look, now remember this particular diagram. So when we see this particular diagram, what we see, there is a dip. So what is this? This is the limb of that strata. So what is happening? It has dipped. And this is the strike, that is part of the same axis that we see, right? So these are at 90 degrees to each other. So this inclination of these rock beds are called the dip. So if we say at what angle it is inclined, that is the dip angle, right? So that is important. And then the angle of dip is measured with instrument which is called clinometer. So remember this clinometer term. And then second term which we have is the strike. So as you saw here, what is a strike? So strike of an inclined bed is the direction of any horizontal line along the bedding plane. So that is the direction of this horizontal line along the bedding plane. So remember, this is the bedding plane on which there is a dip. So that is important here. So that is what strike means. So dip and strike is almost perpendicular at 90 degrees. So why do we study it? So dip determines the direction and angle between the maximum slope and the horizontal plane. So that's why dip is important. That this angle, this maximum slope determination is important. That's why when people study the slope or they assess slope, they measure dip and strike using this instrument called clinometer. And the point to remember is that the dip, the direction of the dip is always at right angle to the strike. So that is important here. Now, let's understand furthermore a little bit more about strike, dip, and another term that is coming here is rake. So what is this rake? So strike is the direction of line formed by intersection of fault plane and horizontal plane, as we see, right? And then this is what we see is the strike line. So fault plane and horizontal plane, right? So that is important here. Then dip is downward inclination of this fault plane relative to the horizontal. So this is particular dip that we see, this angle, right? And so rake is what? The direction of motion on fault measured anti-clockwise on fault plane. So when we know this fault plane, what we see is this particular direction which is measured in the anti-clockwise direction. So that is important. That is called rake. So remember, strike, dip, and rake. Now let's look at the components of a fault, right? So components of fault, as we know, dip, strike, we have already understood. Now there is something called hanging wall block. Why it is hanging? Because this has moved down and this portion of this wall is hanging in the air. So that is why it is called hanging wall. Then further, what we see is the strike slip faulting. So this is along this particular line of strike. Then what we have is hanging wall block. So remember, hanging wall block is here itself, what we have discussed. Then further, this wall has gone down. It is called foot wall. So that is why it is foot wall. So that is important here. Now let's look further. So the plane along which the rocks blocks are displaced is called fault plane, right? So as we know, this particular plane, that is fault plane, right? So this is what is important. A fault may be vertical, inclined, horizontal, or any of this particular type and form. So the movement responsible for the formation of a fault operates in vertical or horizontal or any particular direction. So as we see, this hanging wall, foot wall, and this portion which is in air is called scar. Many times it is also referred to as scarp slope. So this is a free wall that we see here. Now let's learn about various types of faults. So the different types of faulting or crustal rocks are determined by direction of the motion that we already know in the fracture plane. So generally, the relative movement or displacement, that is the major crux of this faulting of the rock blocks, occur approximately in two directions. So as we have already studied, dip and strike. So in reference to that, to the direction of dip, that is dip slip movement. So it slips along the line of dip, or to the direction of the strike. So it is called strike slip movements, right? So these are the two major types on the direction that we see, that dip slip movement happens or strike slip movement happens. So let's learn about the types of faults. So thus, on the basis of direction of slip or displacement, we have dip slip and strike slip fault. So how does it look? They're dip slip fault. Now this is the angle. What we see here is it's slipping along this dip line, isn't it? So that is important. And what we see here is the normal fault or the thrust, that is called reverse fault. So normal fault is we have one hanging wall, one is foot wall, but hanging wall is here now going down, that is coming with the force. So what we see here is this particular slope, which we call scarp, is not hanging in the air. But if it is just opposite, what will happen? This particular portion will hang in the air. So that is important here. So remember, this place, what is reverse fault, has this hanging scarp, but normal fault does not have a hanging scarp. So what we see is the normal fault occurs mainly in areas where the crust is being extended. So what we see is this crust is now getting extension here. So there is gain of crust. So remember, if the question is in which of the fault there is a gain of crust. So crust gaining happens in normal fault, but there is a loss of crust because this is further going to be eroded, right? So there is a loss of crust, and remember, it is a divergent boundary and it is a convergent boundary where it happens. So reverse fault happens where there is a convergence, but normal faulting happens where there is a divergence. So that is very clear in these two diagrams. So remember this and practice it along with the diagram. So this is dip slip. Now, example, if you look at, the best example in the world is this Sinai Peninsula as we see here, right? So what is happening here? Just look. This is now diverging away, right? And this material is now slipping down. So that we have studied, this block and this block, one is slipping down. So that is happening. So continuous downfaulted blocks are happening. And the material from asthenosphere is gradually coming into this. So this is what is happening beneath the Red Sea, and where we see is Egypt and Saudi Arabia. So this is a rift valley which is being formed here. So that is important here. Now let's observe the second type, which is called strike slip. So earlier what we saw was along the dip, right? But here what we see is along this line, the horizontal, right? So this is what we see is the movement. So along the strike. So when it is left lateral strike or strike slip fault, then it is called sinistral. So remember, left is for sinistral and right is for dextral. So what is left and right here? See, this is where we see there is a scarp which is developed, right, in the left portion. So that is what is called strike slip left, and strike slip right is where in the right side we have this particular strike happening. So sinistral or dextral or strike slip right. So left is for sinistral. Many people who ride with the left hand are also known as sinistrals. So that is important here to remember. So sinistral fault and dextral fault. Dextral is movement towards right. Sinistral is movement towards left along strike slip, that is along the line of strike. So one of the best examples we can see here is at the San Andreas fault, right? So what we observe here is this particular fault of San Andreas, and we observe this particular fault, and what is happening here? This is along the horizontal, right? It's not vertical, but rather horizontal movement, and that is what is happening here, the strike movement or this movement along the strike. So that is important. So what we observe is another kind of fault, that is the step fault or the transcurrent fault. Now remember this step word, it is just like a stair. So what is happening here? The stair formation is happening. So when a series of faults occur in an area in such a way that slopes of all the fault planes are in the same direction. Now remember, which are the fault planes? Number one, number two, number three. So remember, all of them have the same direction, isn't it? So that is important here. So when the all fault planes are in same direction, the resultant is this particular step, what we say. So this is what is called step fault or transcurrent fault. Now let's understand the landforms that is formed because of this process of faulting. So those landforms are called block mountains or horst or rift valley or graben. So horst and graben structure, just remember this image. So what is there? The down thrown is called the graben. So basically it is like a valley which is formed because of the faulting, and the ridge which is formed because of this faulting is called horst, right, which is called block mountain. So block mountain and rift valley, whenever you hear, remember it is because of this diastrophic movement of the earth, because of this faulting that we say, where displacement is important, right? Now let's look at further more examples. So due to the compressional forces, the middle section of the rocks are uplifted, resulting it to be the higher than the surrounding land. So as we saw that if this particular portion is uplifted than the surrounding part, then what happens? This is the upthrown block. So this is what we say is horst. An example are Sierra Nevada in North America, Black Forest Mountains in Germany. So that is what we call as block mountains or horst. So rift valley or graben, it's just opposite. So what happens here? Let's see. It represents a trough, that is depression or basin between two crustal parts. So what is happening here now? This is going down. So this particular is now called what we observe as, this is the rift valley which has gone down. So earlier it used to be here, now it has gone down. So this is called Graben, which is formed, a German word which means trough like depression. So examples, Rhine rift valley, Narmada and Tapi rift valley in India. So that is important. Now further, to explain this process of formation of rift valley, there is a scientist named Bullard who gave this hypothesis of origin of rift valleys. So remember, when you are preparing an answer, you have to write the name of this scholar who gave this hypothesis for the formation of this rift valley. And these are the steps. Step number one, step number two, and then step number three. So can you observe here what is happening? First of all, there is this line, this what we know as the fault line. So along which there is a movement possibility. So what is happening? The forces are coming inside, which are compressional in nature. So it is being pushed, right? Again, because of the pressure from this side, this is also having this crack, fracture developed, and this is also being pushed up. So what happens? This goes down. So this is what is happening in the third image. If you see, this is being pushed up, this is being pushed up, and this has gone down. So this is where we call Horst and Graben structure formation. Right? And this is what we understand through the hypothesis of E.C. Bullard. The formation of rift valley is completed through a series of sequential phase of compressional forces. So that is what the hypothesis states. So remember the name, the statement, and this diagram. That is because of the compressional forces. Now let's look at certain examples from different portions of the world. So what we observe as the Horst and Graben formations. So what we see is, the examples are Sierra Nevada block mountains in North America. You can look into the picture. Then what we have is the Great African Rift Valley as an example. So valley floor is what we call as Graben formation. Then we have Rhine Valley in Europe, so which is completely a rift valley we see. Then further, Vosges Mountain in Europe. So Vosges Mountain in Europe is also part of the Horst and Graben structure. Then in India we see the mountain ranges of Satpura and Vindhya, where we have the flow of Narmada and Tapi river that flow through the rift valleys. So these mountains are what we understand as the Horst. Remember the Horst and Graben structure? So that we say. So that is important in terms of India.
So now, when we have learnt about all those important types and characteristics of the fault, in the lectures to come, we are going to learn more on the different aspects of landforms and processes. So stay tuned, stay safe, and all my best wishes to you.